I was wondering one thing. It's actually something I wouldn't want to have to deal with that you do, and it's this sort of idea of how do you manage change? And we've seen it more recently in the last few years when something that's super established in people's hearts and minds and it gets redesigned, and whether it's better or not, everybody hates it, right? Because it's change. And and I would say Facebook's probably the same thing, right? You change the corner radius on a button and you get mounds of hate mail, right? So, I mean, how do you manage that of progressing forward at the same time, you know, even if you're really improving something, people are probably gonna hate it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, first of all, like, everything that we do needs to be steeped in empathy. Yeah. And change aversion is like, is the critical piece where you need to not get too, not too in love with your own solution, that you lose sight of the fact that it is really hard to change things for people. People build muscle memory around stuff. And they, especially in kind of user-generated content context, they feel a real sense of ownership over the product, and they should. Because guess what? Like, none of these products would matter if people didn't create videos or create posts or create websites that could be indexed by a search engine. Like, we would be nothing. And so they do have a sense of ownership over it. And so I think reminding yourself of that and approaching the introduction of change with that sense of empathy is a huge part of it. That's why the design of, like, what we call in the industry a NUX, like the new user experience, is a huge part of the success, because introducing that change is the difference between somebody accepting the organ and rejecting the organ. Right? Because we test the crap out of this stuff before we release it. We're usually highly confident that it's actually a better, more effective design. I mean, occasionally we get it wrong. But most of the time, we actually like know it's an empirically better design. But you know, the fact is people get really efficient at using bad design.
Yeah.
I mean, this is particularly true in the space that I'm working in, which is really around work tools. And like, if you're using a tool 8 to 10 hours a day, you can become incredibly efficient, right?
Yeah,
and so when somebody moves that cheese, even if it's like, you know, brie instead of American processed cheese, like, it's a better cheese, but like, it moved, and you know, it causes a lot of consternation, legitimate consternation.
Yeah. Well, the one thing I also saw that you said, which I thought was interesting in this context, right, in this area of design, of massive design, that no detail is too small, right? So I was gonna ask you, is there something, like, is there a detail that you messed with that just, it had an impact that you couldn't believe in? Was there something that seemed to many of us might seem very small, but had a huge impact?
Well, I mean, in terms of a specific example, like, I look back on, for instance, you know, some of the changes that we made to the YouTube player page, where we knew that the 5-star rating system was really inefficient because it created a ton of cognitive load for people. Because the reality is, like, there were a handful of people using 1-star to say, I hate this video, but like, the vast majority of people were using 5 and nobody was using 2, 3, or 4. And it was just like a completely like ineffective interface. People were very attached to it. But we knew that that cognitive load was actually probably keeping people from engaging and giving us a signal one way or the other about whether or not they liked it. And I think we knew that it would be beneficial, but we didn't know. And like, it was significantly different. You know, the extent to which just dropping that barrier and simplifying the system in a pretty like simple way just opened up a whole new category of engagement for a population that just like didn't want to think through 5, you know? Well, and again, it's like, you got to respect people's time.
Sure.
You know, this is a value exchange. I'm going to give you information. What are you giving to me in return? And it's just not worth it to think through 5 stars, but 2, I mean, I'll think through that.